might show more later on.
10 times of the limit which is available. LR is what we need to understand is it's a window which is being given for an Indian resident to invest abroad. We need to take care as to the LRS master's direction, which is available on the RBI website, is very clear as to what all things are allowed and what all things are not allowed. Most important thing is now, from 2004 to 2020, the law has evolved and the whole LRS scheme has now been divided into two parts. One is the capital account transaction and another is a current account transaction. So certain capital account transaction, you are allowed. Certain current account transaction, you are allowed. But for an individual, everything has been subsumed into a one limit of $2,50,000. Even at ODI, what we were discussing, overseas direct investment by individual, even that falls in the category of $2,50,000. So this care we need to take, that the money which is going to be remitted outside India will have to be within that $2,50,000. Now there is a recent amendment in income tax about the TCS and all, but we will not go because this whole course is about the FEMA. So let us discuss only keeping in mind about the FEMA. When you are sending $2,50,000 by way of remittance, what is allowed is per person per financial year. So now let's say if a family has four members, husband, wife and two children, you can send $1 million abroad. And where you can send $1 million abroad? You can send it to a bank account abroad. You can send it to various other places. And you can take it to the various places by way of investment in the shares, securities, bank account, bond, various other places it is permissible, buying a property abroad, giving a gift. So all these things I will come in. But yes, what needs to be seen here is consolidation is possible. But when you are investing into a property abroad, care needs to be taken that when you are investing, it has to be into the joint name. So let's say four family members who have invested abroad or you have remitted from India outside, all four people should be the owner or what we call it as a co-owner. It is not possible where you all four people send the money from India and only one person gets it registered in its name. There are a series of compounding orders which is available on the RBI website wherein this is clear that yes, because the investment was made by four people, but the ownership is in one name, it leads to a compounding. So it is mandatory. Now, what care needs to be taken? Under LRS, a resident Indian cannot gift it to another resident Indian. What is allowed is remittances outside India to be gifted to a non-resident. So this care needs to be taken that it cannot be used for the gifting it to another resident Indian. This has to be a own fund. It cannot be a loan fund. Loan fund is allowed for the educational purpose. But when it comes to a capital account transaction, this is a differentiation. A loan fund can be allowed for education abroad, for medical treatment abroad, because those are current account transaction. But for a capital account transaction under LRS, loan fund is not allowed. The biggest advantage of LRS fund going abroad is you can invest abroad. The amount which is generated outside out of this investment can still be kept abroad. No need to bring it back to India. Now, before going to the current account transaction, let me go to the capital account transaction because this is the most important thing. Under capital account transaction, there are only six categories which is allowed. But whereas under the current account transaction, there are various other categories which is allowed. So let me go to the capital account transaction. These are the six playthings which is allowed. Opening a foreign bank account is allowed in foreign currency. So if you want to open a bank account in Singapore, you can have it in Singapore dollar, US dollar, pound, euro allowed. You can have it in your individual name. You can have it jointly with your wife or with your minor children. Everything is permissible. But as it is said, from resident to resident, you cannot do it. So let's say if the foreign bank account is open in the name of husband only, But if the wife is remitting from India, she cannot remit to this account because this is not owned by wife also. So this care needs to be taken. Second is purchase of property abroad. You can buy property abroad by clubbing it together, or another option is you have opened a bank account abroad, send $250,000 every year, maybe after 3 years, 4 years, you accumulate the amount what is required, you can use it for those purpose. Making investment abroad. When we say investment abroad is a very loose term, but since it's a capital account transaction, care needs to be taken is what type of investment it is allowed. Acquisition of shares of the listed, unlisted company is allowed. Investment in the debt instrument is allowed. There is a thin line of difference between a debt instrument and a loan. But if you go to authorized dealer and say, okay, I want to send the money abroad by way of loan, they will not allow you to send it. But the moment you say it's a debt instrument, they will allow. Investment in equity, listed company, non-listed company is all allowed. Now, when we say making investment abroad, even buying gold is allowed. As a first thing can come in our mind, because buying a gold in India is expensive, buying a gold in Dubai or another country is little cheaper. But let me tell you, friend, under capital account transaction, only what is specified it is allowed. Sold is not allowed, and it will not be considered as a permissible capital account transaction under LRS, because there is another rule under the custom duty which applies, where if you have purchased any gold abroad, you need to import it back to India. You cannot hold it abroad. So care needs to be taken is when you are giving an advice, we are all professional brothers and sisters. When a client comes to us and need to ask, because in everybody's life, whether it is a client, whether it is the family member, or whether it is a relatives, everybody or somebody will have who are abroad. So when the LRS limit, what I can send, father, son wants to give it to the son who is abroad to buy a property. Can he give a gift? Yes. When you give a loan, no. So all these are thin line of difference. But when we are advising, this care needs to be taken. LRS. When I said shares, it is allowed. Even for the purpose of ESOPs, it is allowed. Investment in mutual fund, it is allowed. Venture capital fund, debt securities, promissory notes. All these are the permissible capital account transaction where you can invest under the LRS. Now, setting up the joint venture was what we saw, which has come on 5th August 2013. I will separately deal with it. Right now, I'm concentrating on investment into the places which is other than the JV and VOS. Now, extending loan to NRIs, it is permissible. You, as an Indian resident, can also give a loan or a gift to your relative, which is defined under the Companies Act 2013. In India, but then an equivalent exchange rate will be considered, and to that extent you can give this gift. Now, these were the discussions relating to LRS transaction, which is allowed under the capital account transaction purpose. Now, let us go back to the current account. Now, what we generally understand, the current account transaction has to be read in sync with how the RBI under FEMA decides it. So now, when we are talking about the liberalized remittance scheme, please make sure that any type of remittance in the nature of margin calls, overseas exchange, or any other counterpart, those things are not allowed. There are little more categories where you cannot invest. Now, dealing in, as mentioned, overseas exchange, remitting for the particular categories like business chit fund, Nidhi fund, agriculture plantation, every such things, what you need to invest abroad is not allowed under the LRS. So this care needs to be taken as to what are allowed and what is not allowed. Now let me come to the permissible current account transaction. So a person who has to visit, like we go for travel, excursion, tour, this limit of $250,000 is allowed. Care needs to be taken is the $250,000 is the upper limit which is allowed. What you can take currency, cash, is a separate limit under the baggage rule. So that care also you need to take as to only those things are allowed. So when you're going abroad, yes, you can carry out the transaction by buying it from the authorized dealer and take it along with you. You can give a gift, you can give a donation. Now, few are the people who goes abroad for the employment, immigration, these or these studies abroad. In these cases, so if you see on my slide, for the purpose of immigration studies and medical treatment, the individual may avail exchange facility for an amount in excess of the limit prescribed under LRS, provided you give a approval route from the Reserve Bank of India. So you make an application and you get the prior approval. Classic cases of the various celebrities who goes for the health reason to America for getting the treatment done. The cost of treatment is much more than $250,000, and nobody has accumulated there because nobody knows at what point of time they may require it. So you make an application, you get a part profile or the quotation from the respective hospital as to this is the amount which will be required along with the person who will be staying with that particular patient. So government is considering for studies abroad, because in foreign country, there are certain educational courts where the cost is more than $250,000. So government keep a note of this. And for this type of transactions, government is allowing beyond $250,000. So now coming back to this, when we are talking about gift, travel, $250,000, maintenance of close relative abroad, it is $250,000. But when it comes to these few categories, then the limit goes beyond $250,000. But yes, it has to be also within the prior approval of Reserve Bank of India. The most interesting things, friend, we are talking about the LRS for an individual. We have a cases where a lawyer, a doctor, a chartered accountant, or any professional or an actor who are individual in their capacity, and if they have to travel abroad for any conference or any such thing which requires remittance of money outside India. Let me tell you, 3-4 years before, a circular has come and they have subsumed all the business transaction along with this current account transaction. So the upper limit still remains at $250,000, not beyond that. So we may say, okay, a lawyer who is going for some professional thing, and if the money has to be spent from his account, then the $250,000 quota limit is only applicable and not the other than. So we all chartered accountant may feel, okay, sir, that is a profit and loss account item. It's not a part of drawings or a capital account adjustment. RBI doesn't consider all these things. RBI will consider this as an overall $250,000, not beyond that. If you're doing a business trip, let me tell you, a business trip done by an individual from his personal account or a proprietary concern, that $250,000 will be applicable. But if he's a partner in the LLP, and if LLP is sponsoring that particular person's trip, then it will not fall within the $250,000. Also, care needs to be taken as to the limit which is prescribed. Business trip, a company is going, then $250,000 is not applicable because the company is sponsoring it, and it is not the case where we as an individual are going to use. So let me tell you a little bit of the procedural part of the LRS. So whoever wants to do an LRS, A, he'll have to go to their authorized dealer, submit form along with form A2. Submit form A2. Along with the A2 form, they will ask the declaration. And with the declaration, they will mention, yes, this remittance is within the $250,000. A self-declaration. A PAN number is compulsory. Now, without PAN number, they are not submitting. Once this application comes to the bank, the authorized dealer will scrutinize the form. They will update everything in the record. They will verify and they will allow you to remit. There is a separate reporting which is called as a fetters, and this needs to be done by the banker and not by the you. This was all relating to the LRS in an individual capacity, certain current account transaction and certain capital account transaction. Now, let me go through the outbound investment which is received through 263 notification of 5th August 2013. The coordinators, what I propose is, do you want me to cover this particular part? Because I do not want to confuse the participants, because certain thing is allowed under LRS individual, but certain things are not allowed under ODI LRS. So I want to keep these two sections separate.
You may keep it separate, Rajesh bhai.
Okay.
Or so, Yanesh bhai can give better advice, I think.
Fine, we will keep it. So
I understand that if we have any questions on the first part, do we want to cover it now? Because we have a couple of questions.
Please go ahead.
Is that, yeah. So Ravi, can you unmute? One second, I'll give you the name of the gentleman. Can you unmute CA Abhirup Agarwal? Uma Mahedokar.
Just a second, I'm doing it. It's a long question, Rajesh bhai. That is why we are unmuting him. To ensure that...
No problem. I am ready to solve all the questions. Don't worry.
Sir, you can speak, Mr. Uma Mahedokar Sanjeev. You can speak. You can unmute yourself.
You can read my question, which has been already given to you. Issue is, one Indian resident has and his wife and two children, adult children. Now they want to buy a property in US. Can they do it? They want to send money and then acquire loan. I have given all facts in this and the question. So it is better if we read the question.
As a speaker, I am not able to see your question.
No, but then no, he will read out.
I'll read it, Rajeshji. Mr. and Mrs. X are Indian residents. Both are only directors of private limited company. The said company does business in India and there is no foreign business and income. Mr. X is 58 years old and Mrs. X is 51 years of age. Both are in the maximum slab of current personal income tax. They have two major sons who are studying abroad. One studying abroad and one in India. Mr. X wants to apply for residency abroad under a scheme under which property has to be purchased in the country of choice.
One minute. These questions refer to my next section. So please do not take it over here.
Sure. No problem.
Okay. I will appreciate questions coming to the slides which I've covered.
Got it.
Fine, thank you. I'll listen to it next time.
Sure. Not next time. Give me half an hour. Your answer, you will get it. Don't worry.
Okay. There are a couple of other questions under, and I'm assuming they are under this. So, is it safe to conclude that any remittance is allowed to be remitted under LRS unless it is prohibited? That is Schedule 1 transaction of current account, which is not allowed. Rest all are allowed, even capital account transaction. I think you have answered this partly, but since this question is raised,
let me tell you, under LRS, as per the master direction, when you talk about a capital account transaction, only the six categories are allowed. Whereas under the current account transaction, yes, whatever is permissible is allowed. So if you go to the master directions on liberalized remittance scheme, six categories are allowed under the capital account transaction. Rest from A to H, there are all current account transaction which is permissible. Over to you.
Right. The other question is, for purchase of immovable property, in the purpose code, the bank is asking to, should it be S0005? That is for purchase of immovable property.
So, sir, if you are investing if you are remitting the money from India and you are clear that you have to invest into the property, yes, you can fit that code. Otherwise, it is just a transfer from Indian bank account to the overseas bank account. Clear?
So, his question is, what should be the purpose code? Purpose code, should it be S0005?
So I have said okay, only if you are buying the property, the code should be S0005. Otherwise, it should be on the remittance or repatriation of capital, there is a separate section or the code for the repatriation of capital. That code should be used.
Okay. So there is another question where there is a company in the UK which has an Indian subsidiary. I think this is related to the next section, but I don't know. It could also fall here.
Whoever is reading the question, make sure that we are talking only about the individuals over here.
Correct. So if
it's the individual,
a resident wants to invest in a company, UK company, which has an Indian subsidiary, would it be allowed? I am assuming it should be, but
No, it is not allowed. Say, question okay. number 64 of the frequently asked questions on ODI, whoever is doing part two will cover that resident Indian cannot invest into a foreign company which has a subsidiary in India. It is not permissible.
Oh, okay.
You can go to question number 64 on the ODI FAQ of the RBI website.
I think we can go ahead. RI has 1% and he has deposited USD in the month for which currency.
Rajesh bhai, let us move forward. We can ask the remaining questions after some time.
Okay, yes. No worries. So friends, as I was mentioning about the LRS transaction, because what we have been discussing is what is allowed from 2004. Now in 2013, Government of India, FEMA, Reserve Bank of India came out with Regulation 20A as a part of Regulation Notification 120. 120 deals with Indian party allowed to invest abroad. In Indian party, earlier it was a partnership firm, private limited, then they included LLP. And they have included certain trust and all those things, but that is under the approval route. But individual are not allowed as an Indian party. There is a separate subsection carved out as a 20A. Now, what does it say? Indian individual can set up company abroad. They can say, they can enter into a joint venture abroad. They can enter into a setting up the company abroad, which is their wholly owned subsidiary. We generally feel wholly owned subsidiary means subsidiary of the Indian company, not necessary. The three family members, three friends, or some like-minded people can come together and create the boss abroad. But what care needs to be taken, that company is not indulge in real estate business. The definition of real estate business is already there in notification number 120. Banking business and the financial services, these are the three main area where you cannot set up the company abroad and use this money for the purpose of this. The said foreign company, JV or VOS, should be engaged in bona fide business activity only. The bona fide business activity is not defined under FEMA 120. I have checked. So the question asks, what is bona fide business activity? When we say bona fide business activity means, if you see the limb above, they do not include real estate, banking, financial. So you want to do any trading, you want to do any service oriented, you want to carry out any manufacturing. These are all permissible. Another important thing is the JV and the VOS should be an operating company. It cannot be an SPV and it cannot have a subsidiary below it. So no step-down subsidiary is allowed to be acquired or set up by the VOS or set up by the resident individual. So I cannot invest into a company which has a subsidiary anywhere. So that example which was giving of section question number 64, it was specifically to the India. But even if it is not into the India, if it is abroad, and resident individual cannot invest into a company or set up a company abroad which has any step-down subsidiary below it. So these are the few restrictions when you are advising your client whether you should set up company abroad as a subsidiary of individual resident or whether as a subsidiary of Indian party, which is a company or an LLP or a partnership firm. My advice is it should be from the company or the LLP or a partnership firm, because there are certain restrictions from the individual point of view which they cannot do it. So care needs to be taken that said RBI, a said individual is not on the RBI's question list. Investment is into those country which is an FTF compliant country. investment needs to be reported within 30 days. In disinvestment should be completed within 60 days reporting. But up to 1 year, the disinvestment is not allowed. APR is applicable to the resident individual. So these were the categories relating to individual investing in the company abroad, which is totally owned by those individuals or through joint venture. So let's say if you are buying the shares of a foreign company like Google or any XYZ, that will not come in this ODI category. That will go into the investment category. But if you are, so this purchase, acquisition of shares are both listed and unlisted. But when you are talking about investment into the shares, which has to be JV was, basically it is to akin to the control. So if you are controlling those things, it will be applicable. If it is not controlled, then you fall in those category. So, but from 2013, every authorized dealer has been given the mandate by the Reserve Bank of India. If any investment is going to acquire the foreign company, to incorporate the foreign company, ODI form is the must. ODI form is a simple form giving the details of the Indian party, overseas party, what is your joint venture ratio sharing, whether it is 100%, who are the people in India who are going to contribute to those. These are the few aspects which one needs to look into while investing under the ODI route. Now, there are certain general permission also available whereby you don't have to go through the approval route. It is automatic and few other categories. Now, like if any person is acquiring any foreign security as a gift, it is permissible. If any person is acquiring shares under the ESOP issued by a company outside India, if there is no involvement of money, allowed. You are required to acquire the shares by way of inheritance from a person, whether he's a resident in India or outside India. So when we say in India, so let us say another person, a father who has invested in LRS abroad, acquired certain shares. Now on his demise, this get bequeathed to his son. So a general permission is being given to the son to acquire the shares by way of inheritance from a person who is a resident in India or outside India. Again, a general permission is given to purchase equity shares offered by a foreign company under his ESOP scheme. Here, when we are talking about the ESOP scheme to purchase is by making the payment. One step up, what we have seen is under the cashless, where you do not involve any remittance outside India. So these are the two differences. But yes, my friend, even if you're buying the ESOP shares, the $2,50,000 will be applicable. Now, resident Indians are also allowed to acquire the foreign security. Friends, the questions was asked in the prior seminar, when my LRS limit is allowing me to send the money abroad and all those things, why this general permission is over here? So let me tell you, this general permission is from the FEMA 1999 when it get enacted. These things are still there from day one when that LRS limit was not applicable. So then you used to go either in this general category or you have to go under the approval category. So now you have a LRS category which is under the automatic route. Then you have a general category where you can go, but the limit all remains the same at $2,50,000 or any limit which is prescribed by the LRS from time to time. Residents are also permitted to acquire the foreign securities. Qualification shares, if you are becoming the director of a foreign company, you will be allowed to send. Now, if any full consideration or part consideration of the foreign shares you are getting in lieu of the professional services, even that is allowed. So all these things what we have seen were falling under the automatic route. Now, approval of the Reserve Bank of India, if you do not fall under the automatic route, you have to go under the approval route. What are the approval route? In approval route, you have to make an application to Reserve Bank of India, giving the circumstances and giving the justification as to why you need to come to Reserve Bank of India. The classic case is, we just applied under the $1 million scheme, which is available to NRI, which must have got covered in the earlier session. Limit is $1 million. So one of my client sold the property for 30 crores of rupees. What was allowed was $1 million. So in the March, they remitted $1 million. In the April, they remitted $1 million. And now they wanted to remit the balance amount net of taxes. We went to Reserve Bank of India, said, see, this is a widow who is settled abroad. It was an own ancestral property from 50 years. They have been abroad from last 15 years. Money lying here, nobody to take care. If we could give a justification, they immediately gave the permission. So coming back to this LRS individual approval route, if any of those people feel that they do not fall under the automatic route, take a case of a $2,50,000 is a limit. We got one of the biggest corporate client of this who wanted to invest under the individual capacity and the limit was $2,50,000. We gave a justification as to why it has to come through the individual route and the Reserve Bank of India gave the permission. Application has to go to authorized dealer. Authorized dealer then it forwarded to the Reserve Bank of India. If you refer directly to Reserve Bank of India, they will return the application back. So all these factors, what we have seen now, is seen by the Reserve Bank of India while granting you under the approval route. But let me come to the immigration, which was one more area and the question which asked in the by the coordinator. Now, EB-5 scheme is one of the scheme which is very famous and we are aware of it. But let me tell you, friend, along other than EB-5, there are 10 countries more who is offering such scheme. So I will just touch upon those schemes. Why this has become all of a sudden very famous and what we hear about it. EB-5 scheme is an investor program where the US government, before issuing the green card, tell the people, ke, are you ready to invest into my country? The people say yes. And the EB-5 doesn't apply to only Indian. It applies to any non-US citizen. Any person from any country can use this EB-5 scheme. So under EB-5 scheme of $500,000, which is $500,000, you invest into a bonds of a US company which is eligible to receive. This is identical to what we have in India. We call it a capital gain account. 54 EC bonds, NHAI, REC, who are allowed to issue the bond, and that helps you to save your capital gain tax in India. Same way under EB-5, you make yourself eligible, send the money from India. The limit is $2,50,000 up to November 2019, which got extended to September 2020, which allowed you $500,000. The limit is now $900,000. So this immigration scheme is where you invest into that country. That country verifies your investment and allows you or grants you the residentship, citizenship, depending upon country to country. So this EB-5 became very famous because every second family who wants to settle in US requires this visa for two reasons. This is a type of below citizenship and more than H1 or L1 visa. Here, you are, once you are a green card holder, you don't require a visa to enter that country. The visa was in the form of a green color card, so that famously it became a green card. Today, there is a queue of 5 to 6 years because not a case that where you invest or you remit money from India and they immediately gives you the green card or the whatever we call it, the prior to citizenship, the visa, what we say. No, you have a queue system over there. You make an application, you make an investment. After 5 years, today the waiting period has gone to 5 years, where a person has to wait. People generally go for this type of visa because either the parents who are in India now want to settle abroad and to take the avail the medical facility which is available to the US citizen, their son or daughter-in-law, or daughter and son-in-law who have settled in US and they want the parents to come over there. So all those things have helped EB-5 to prosper. Now, up to November 19, the limit was $500,000, which is increased. So depending upon the criteria and all, it has gone. A couple requires other category and all those things. Now, let me come to the other countries. There is a Dominica, there is a Grenada, where you invest $100,000. Investment is into the real estate company. Once they approve it and you get a citizenship or the residential visa, these are all akin to this. People take the Grenada visa because that is a stepping stone to the US visa. So once you get the Grenada visa, then this under the E2 program, you can apply for the US visa. Cyprus. Cyprus is the most expensive because it requires $2 million of investment So many clients come to us and say, how, sir, we can make a $2 million of investment. So it's a planning. You cannot do upfront. It has to be over a period of time. Accumulate your money abroad, all legitimate money through the banking channel, and then you start making the investment. Turkey offers you at $250,000. St. Lucia is an island. So if you see a few island countries, there the cost is cheap. Whereas if you see a respectable jurisdiction, the cost is high. So all these countries, Malta, Portugal, they all have, if you see a Malta is 1.1 million, but it is less compared to the Cyprus, which is 2 million. So European country, the costing is higher. If you see those islands and all, the costing is less. Now, how do you send the money? Let's say if a family of four who has to invest in this EB-5 scheme, and I'm talking about the revised limit, what needs to be done is a bank account has to be opened. The money has to go in 1 year. It has to get accumulated. Then only you can make an investment. In one immediate for 1 year, you cannot consolidate, because in the EB-5 scheme, generally it is the head of the family who makes an applicant, and they say the balance are the dependent. So if they are dependent in the application, the bond will come in the name of the individual. Hence, it is not permissible to have a consolidation, because what we saw in the LRS limit, the consolidation is possible, but that consolidation has to be in the joint name. They all have to be a co-owner. So Malta, Portugal, all what we have decided. So this was relating to the LRS outbound investment and the incentive investment programs under the immigration laws while a person who has to go abroad. With this, now I will hand over back to the coordinator, and coordinator, over to you for the questions. Now I can take all the questions relating to the LRS, individual, company, and the EB-5. Please, over to you, Ravi bhai. Am I audible?
Yeah. Neeraj ji, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. So I'm just running through the questions.
I think one participant had raised query recently. I think you can cover that now because her
topic. Inesh bhai, you can see those queries, but I cannot see, right?
No, I also cannot see. They have a separate Google form, but the lady who had recently asked question, you can take up. Rajesh bhai, you can read her query. I think now we can cover actually.
I do not have a chat mode, Inesh bhai.
We have not activated chat mode actually.
Okay, yeah, okay, understood.
I'll read out that question, but before that, there's another question. Yeah. One individual incorporated a company in UK and happens to be one of the director in India. I'm not sure what he means. In few days of incorporation, he wants to make that company as a subsidiary of Indian company. Your direction required.
So what I understand from this simple question is, and the company is incorporated by an Indian under the ODI. So if he has filed ODI, and now if he wants to convert into the Indian company making the subsidiary, up to 1 year, the Reserve Bank of India will not allow you, because you can dilute or anything after 1 year. So you can go to your authorized dealer after 1 year and make an application and convert it at the individual level. But my suggestion is, if you have not done it, create a new company, have your base, which has to be clean. Straight away, the Indian resident company, invest into that London company and close the matter. Next.
Okay. There's another question by Mr. Aditya S. So he's referring to slide 13. So he says, if a consultant, say an accountant who is not an employee, is given stock options of a foreign company against the services that he has rendered to the Indian subsidiary of foreign company. So basically, I don't know how we can call it. It's not an employee stock option. It's a kind of consultant stock option where he is providing services to the Indian subsidiary, but he is given shares of the holding company outside India, and it is a cashless stock option. Is it permissible? However, there is a strike price minimum amount to acquire this stock option. Would it still be allowed?
Okay, so this is covered in the general category where an individual person, this is what we call it is capitalization of export. So when this individual is giving services to a foreign Indian company, right? Because it's an Indian yes. subsidiary.
Correct.
So when a services is given to the Indian subsidiary and the money is coming in the form of ESOPs, it is as good as a gift being received to that individual, which is permissible.
Okay. There's another question. If a person purchases 100%, this is by Divya Agarwal. If a person purchases 100% equity investment in foreign abroad dealing with marketing services of pharmaceutical products, and then further wants to either enter incentive-based sale plan with the foreign LLC as they are involved in distribution, marketing, and logistics services in addition to marketing, is it allowed to send incentive commission payment under LRS?
Please go ahead. Please complete the question.
If not, is it recommended to acquire wholly owned subsidiary through LLP in which that person is a partner so as to allow commission payment?
See, I think in this question, things is not coming clear. What I've understood is the Indian individual has invested into a foreign company who is into the marketing of the pharma company. All activities are taken care at the pharma company level, which is abroad. So how under the LRS you will be sending the incentive commission? Because as nomenclature, what it will be given? A, it has to be in the form of capital account transaction or current account transaction which is linked to an individual. Now here you are making the payment on behalf of the foreign company. The marketing services is done by the foreign company. Hence, any payment has to be done, it has to be done by the foreign company. Now if you want to capitalize that foreign company, you can send from here the equity but not the incentive. If my answer is not satisfactory, the said question can be raised by the person if he requires any further clarification. Because my answer depends upon the facts of the case, what is given. There may be something in their mind which may not be coming out of the question.
Yeah, even I thought there was a bit of lack of clarity in the question. So this is another question, which is, I think we have an answer for that, which is by C.A. Sulabh Lohia. And this is a LRS by individual. Can a ODI company, he's saying LRS by individual, but again saying ODI company. So ODI, I'm assuming it's a ODI by individual, do investment business, that is derivative sale purchase.
The investment business, or you call it as a derivative, is a financial activity. And financial activity do not fall under the automatic rule. If you see this slide, very clearly mentioned the JV was cannot be engaged in real estate business, financial services, or banking business. So it will, for derivatives, will be a financial activity and not will be allowed.
Fair.
Next.
I also believe in this overseas direct investment. I'm just adding to it and asking my own question kind of. In this overseas direct investment, I can only make investment in securities abroad which result in delivery. So derivatives cannot be traded, was my understanding. So probably the question is from that perspective.
Absolutely right.
Right. So I hope that answers your question, C.S. Sulabh Lohia. And
so if you see this slide, very clearly mentioned, all other transactions in the nature of remittance for margin or margin call to overseas exchange, overseas are not allowed under the scheme.
Right. So this is another question by Abhirup Agarwal, CA Abhirup Agarwal. Under investment in various countries for visa, is there a lock-in for investment made or can we liquidate after some period or can it be sold and reinvested? I think this question is more related to the laws of that country.
And I have the answer, sir. We expertise, yeah, so we know it. I will explain you. So when, please. Friend, when you're talking about the US, there is a lock-in of 6 years. Whereas you're talking about the Malta, in Malta, you have to purchase the property. In Cyprus, you have to invest into the real estate. Once you have invested into real estate, then you can liquidate it after you get it. But the problem is, it is not easy in those countries to liquidate so soon. So it has, it will remain invested. When you talk about sand kits, again in the sand kits, you will have to keep it invested. So, but whereas in Malta, you make an investment into bonds. Bonds in Malta is for the period of 5 years. So all these country are specific. You can go to the website, you will get the answer. Or if you have any specific questions, then it can be done. But more important is not the dilution. Important is whether you want a, whether your client wants an European country or whether it wants a Caribbean island or anything, that care needs to be taken. So if you see in my slide, time to citizenship is mentioned. It takes 6 years. Now, when some countries take 6 years to give citizenship, you cannot dilute those investment and get away with. So all depends upon country to country. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So there's one question, again, not very clear. This is by Mr. Mukesh Madan. A resident individual has 1% company in USA. He deposited some USD in that account in cash, for which the currency was officially purchased in India. Out of this account, he has invested 500 USD as capital in the US company. What compliance is required? So I'm assuming he must have taken some travel advance or currency from here and then went abroad, gone abroad and set up a company there in the US. And now he wants to report this.
So let me tell you, it's a fit case for, if it is a fit case for compounding, because when you take a travel quota, you make a declaration that this money which I'm utilizing, or sorry, which you are acquiring from the authorized dealer will be utilized for the purpose of current account transaction, for my expenses, for my travel, for my hotel. It investing into an another company by giving $10 or $100, that investment in company is a capital account transaction and it has to be going through the banking channel only. So if you go on the RBI website and do a search for the compounding orders, there are more than 7 orders on this particular fact, where any money which is going through the basic quota utilized for the setting of the company abroad, RBI asks you to come in compounding. Clear?
Right.
So there is one more question. How will be the reporting done in case of capitalization of export to overseas subsidiary?
So when you're talking about capitalization of export to the overseas subsidiary, that will be covered in ODI part 2, whereby when you have exported the goods, you have to receive the money. Your EDPMS has got activated, which says that there is a bill of lading of, let's say, $10,000 worth of goods you have exported to your subsidiary. Now your subsidiary are issuing shares within that 180 days. If the shares are issued after 180 days, it doesn't come under the automatic route. Then you have to go under the approval route. So once you are getting the shares of your subsidiary, then you need to have that form ODI, because technically you have invested into that company, but the money is not going from here. And if you see the ODI, there is a form where it says okay, the currency is purchased from the market, whether it is from EEFC account or whether there is a capitalization of export. So you have to tick capitalization of export and then the authorized dealer captures your investment.
Okay. Now, this is the question that we had taken up before the end of part one, and which...
The first question...
Yes, which part of it we have answered in your presentation. The other part, so this is a property where a person who is an Indian resident, to Mr. and Mrs. X, who are both Indian residents and are directors of private company, they have no foreign business, and age and income criteria, other things are given. I don't know whether those are relevant. They have 2 children, one studying abroad and one in India. Okay, and they want to purchase a property abroad for the purpose of visa and to become a non-resident eventually. Property and related taxes would come to about 4 million euro, of which 500,000 in the current fiscal year would be remitted from India, and the rest would be a loan from commercial bank of the country with about 2% per annum interest and a term of 40 years. The question is, legal fees regarding this matter needs to be paid immediately in this financial year amounting to 18,000. Can this be done? Considering no other, so considering, I'll just read out all the questions. There are five questions. Considering no other remittance have been made in the current year, can both X, Mr. X and Mrs. X remit 250,000 each in the current financial year? It is contemplated that a property would be jointly owned by Mr. and Mrs. X, or it may be jointly owned by Mr. and Mrs. X and their two sons. And can Mr. and Mrs. X give their sons equivalent of 250,000 individually in Indian rupees? And can the sons in turn remit this amount abroad towards buying of the property?
Neeraj bhai, let me pause you for a minute, because this transaction is void ab initio, because what the question says is you are going to take a loan of 4 million.
Right.
Buying a property abroad by taking a loan in the individual name is not permissible at all. It is void ab initio. You can go to the website. There is a recent case of a individual which is represented by our firm, where the person has acquired a Dubai property by taking a loan from abroad, and RBI said ke no, it is a violation. It was a case of a simple 1 million dirham loan, which is not even limit of 5 lakh dollar which is allowed between husband and wife, but still they got convinced that they should go for a loan. They did not inform us for the 2 years. Then the chartered accountant revealed that they have taken a loan. We immediately told them to close this thing. They got away by just paying 1 lakh rupees as a compounding fees. But yes, the first thing is you cannot take a loan. Second, if you have taken a loan, they will ask you to close the loan account, close the loan, pay it from here. And third, I mean compounding. So your transaction about who gives how much and all doesn't become relevant over here, because this transaction is not possible, because 4 million loan is a big amount.
Fair enough.
Over to you.
Yeah. So there is a supplementary question on that cash investment of $500 in company out of in a company out of travel quota. So what is the procedure to be followed for compounding, because the money cannot be withdrawn from the company?
My friend, you have a separate session by your organizer for the compounding of offenses. That speaker will cover everything. But let me tell you, the 7-8 questions which are raised, all are a fit case for compounding, and we professionals will make money out of it as a professional fees. Thank you.
Right. All right. We can continue with the session, Rajesh bhai.
No live questions you are taking, because I still have 4-5 minutes before I move to the next session. Any live questions you want to take, or you want to?
So generally, the procedure that we are following is even if there's a long question or where we are not able to understand, we are taking those as live questions, like we tried to do last time. But
so you want to take that lady who was speaking? I can answer her now. No problem.
No, that was the question we discussed, where we talked about a loan, the 4 million.
Okay, okay, okay. So fine. Yeah. So let us move ahead.
Yeah.
Because our endeavor as an organizer, as a speaker, is that all the participants, whoever are part of this conference, should get all their questions resolved.
Correct.
Okay.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So friends, let me come back to this drawing, position and utilization of foreign currency. This is most important thing today, because section 3, 6, 8, 9, which you will be learning through, FEMA is the smallest of the smallest law compared to anything, but because of the rules and regulation, it has become one of the biggest rule. But still, the fundamental, if you want to understand, the section is very clear. If you understand the section, the fundamental is clear, you don't have to worry about, because fundamental is what the base is all about. So let me tell you, what does section 3 says? All dealing in foreign exchange or foreign security can be done only through the authorized person if permitted by the FEMA rules, regulation, by the general or the special permission of Reserve Bank of India. Further, no payment can be made by resident to a non-resident unless permitted under FEMA. Proviso to Section 6.2, Reserve Bank or the central government shall not impose any restriction on the drawal of foreign exchange for payment due on account of amortization of loan or for depreciation of direct investment, shall not any restriction on the drawal of foreign exchange for any payment due on account of amortization. This now utilization of foreign currency, in terms of Section 5, a person resident in India like we are free to buy or sell foreign exchange for any current account transaction, except for those the transaction of which are prohibited. That is Schedule 1, Schedule 3. Schedule 1 is a prohibited section. Schedule 3 of the current account transaction rules regulation talks about the limits which has to be followed, and Schedule 3 which is allowed. So everything is allowed unless restricted. In current account transaction, everything is allowed unless they are specified. Now, what are the prohibitions for the use of foreign currency? Now, the foreign currency, these are part of Schedule 1. We are all well versed with this. Buying the lottery ticket abroad, income from racing. So we have a classic case of when you go to the Dubai airport, there is a car which is available, very fancy car, where it says ke lucky draw. You just take a ticket and there are chances you may win the ticket. The problem came up because the person who had gone with his basic travel quota used that travel quota to acquire that ticket and luckily won the lottery also. But the problem is he ended up paying the huge amount as a compounding fees because it was a prohibited transaction and you are not allowed to carry all this thing. Remittances for purchase of lottery ticket, bank prescribed magazines, the nature of A, not permissible, B, payment of commission.
Your voice is breaking up, Rajesh.
Am I audible now again?
Yeah, better now.
Sorry. Better now? Yeah. So these are the friends whereby your investment or your money which is going abroad, these are the prohibited categories where you cannot send the money for. Now comes holding. This is the most
important. Rajesh bhai, may I suggest that you switch off your video?
Okay. My video is stopped. Now am I audible?
Yes, the voice is much better now.
Okay, so let's go back to the... Okay. So when we are talking about the holding, surrender of foreign exchange, what we are trying to say, let me tell you, friend, today we who buy the foreign exchange, we are buying from the government through the authorized dealer. The money may belong to you, but the foreign currency belongs to the government of India. Hence, what we need to take care is for what purpose it is acquired. It has to be used for that purpose. And after the purpose is achieved, when you come back to India, whatever is the balance lying, there is a rule restriction within which you will have to surrender it back to this. So let's say we as a professional who go abroad, earn foreign professional fees, and then when you bring it back to India, if it is in the form of wire transfer, it has to be remitted back to India. If it is in the form of currency, you need to submit it back to the authorized dealer. You cannot retain. There are separate categories is mentioned in Section 8 and 9, which deals with this. So now person resident in India is prohibited from acquiring, holding, owning, possession of any foreign exchange, security or immovable property outside India. They are required to repatriate and bring to India all foreign exchange that is due or accrued to them and deposit the same in the bank account. This is a very simple definition what we see. But the most important thing is today what we are seeing about this black money law, money laundering case, everything is arising from this because a person resident in India are prohibited from acquiring property abroad unless it is permissible. They are not allowed to hold foreign security unless it is permissible. They cannot buy immovable property unless and until within it is within the four corners of the law. So let's say a person who is having the bank account abroad, HSBC are the famous cases where those money lying abroad, the beneficial owner is an Indian resident, then it is prohibited. You or me cannot have those things abroad. Surrender of foreign exchange. When we are talking about surrendering the foreign exchange, 180 days is a thumb rule what we need to understand. But up to $2,000 is the limit which has been given where you can keep it. The limit of $2,000 is applicable only to the notes. it is not applicable to the coin. So person who has a hobby of collecting foreign coins, they can do it without any limit. There is no restrictions which is prescribed. Only applicable to the notes. That is also up to 2000 equivalent USD. Otherwise, you will have to surrender it. When we are talking about the revenue which is generated abroad, it needs to be surrendered within 7 days. That 180 days is available only when you are taken under the BTQ. So a classic case is, let's say for a company who has sent his executive abroad for the purpose of business, let's say he buys a Australian dollar because he goes to Australia for the purpose of some business opportunity. He comes back. He has $5,000 lying in the physical currency or whether also into those foreign currency card, the top-up card, what we call. Those cards have those. Now, at the end of 180 days, nobody has traveled from the company. That currency is lying with the cashier. It needs to be surrendered back to the authorized dealer. In the case of the top-up card, a email comes from the respective issuer card agency. Hey, you have exhausting the limit of 180 days. You are required to surrender the foreign currency back to the authorized dealer. So when you are talking about surrender of foreign currency, let me tell you, foreign currency, when we read in the newspaper, is so and so being raided and so much of foreign currency has been acquired. This is legally wrong because as per law, only $2,000 is allowed. So if any currency which is found, it gets immediately, the ED comes into the role and they confiscate this foreign currency, and a separate case under the ED, under the PMLA, starts on the respective person, irrespective of the amount which will be offered for taxation. So let's say he, a professional, went abroad, got $10,000 as his fees, and he did not surrender and he kept it in his drawer. For the income tax purpose, let's say he has declared it, still it becomes a violation under the FEMA, and ED has a right to adjudicate and confiscate that amount. So this holding, acquiring and surrendering of currency is an utmost important, because what we need to understand is you are allowed to hold this thing only to the extent whatever is limited. Beyond that, you will not be allowed. We have three more cases. In the case of LRS, when you send the money abroad, you are allowed to invest abroad. Once you get some return, you are allowed to hold it in the foreign currency bank account abroad. But once you bring it back to India, you will not be allowed to continue. It has to get converted into Indian rupees. Now, let me tell you what are the different type of foreign currency accounts, which is very important. I understand that foreign currency account will be dealt by a person who is handling different type of bank account, or whether it is already covered, then I may not cover.
You may please go ahead. Right?
Okay, fine. So now, friends, what is important is the different type of foreign currency account which is allowed in India. Then I will come abroad also. A residence have been allowed to maintain foreign currency account in the form of EFC. Very important to note, EFC is only out of your earning abroad, which you can bring it in the dollar or foreign currency. A person who is receiving any income, like we as a professional or an exporter who exports outside India, that person is allowed to retain that money in EFC account. Earlier, the law was you can convert 50, you will have to convert 50% into Indian rupees. You can continue with 50%. Law has kept on changing depending upon the requirement by the statistics decision. Now, any money which is received, let's say today we are on 14th of August. Any money which is received on 14th August in EFC account, you have 1 month and a half month. So by the end of the next month, you have to convert it back to normal account, or you can send it back abroad for whatever purpose you want to do it. So a care needs to be taken that EFC is only allowed to the income. We had a classic case whereby an Indian company received FDI from abroad. So when they receive FDI from abroad, one banker without the knowledge credited it to the EFC account. It was said ki yes, it is not allowed. It has to be converted into for the FDI. EFC account is not allowed. So there was two violation. One violation was it got credited to EFC account, and second violation is did not convert it, got converted immediately. Because I'm talking about the era where 50% were allowed to be held in the foreign currency. Second is the resident foreign currency domestic account. Now let's say a person who was abroad, who comes to an India, and he decides to settle into India and become a resident. And if he have a foreign currency account in India, he is allowed to have a resident foreign currency domestic account, whereby the money will get deposited or will remain in that foreign currency account. It can be in the form of deposit. If it is an FCNR account, deposit account, it get converted into FCNR account for the time being. And if the Indian individual who has become a resident of India decides, you know, I need to continue with that foreign currency, because what we are seeing over a period of time, dollar was 60, 70, now 75. He may think the dollar will become 90. So he can continue with those foreign currency dominated account. There is a diamond dollar account also which had come. The diamond dollar account is all about a account which was available to the diamond industry, because what we see in the diamond industry, if you have clients, they used to import rough and export polish. Then there was a cases, because what used to happen, when you used to get the money for the polished diamond and when they had to make the payment, there was an exchange difference, the fluctuation. So that industry went to the government and said, see, our Indian cost of operation is less. My major portion is in the form of purchase and sale of the diamond trading. And 90% of the money goes for this purpose. And we are into a big problem when this thing fluctuation take place and all. So government came up and they said, okay, you will be allowed to use this as a diamond dollar account only for this trading activities or manufacturing activities relating to your industry only. So this benefit was given to this. So friends, what I've tried to cover is the foreign currency account where you can continue to have a dollar account in India. Now, let me tell you, continuing the foreign currency account abroad. So what we have seen under the LRS, yes, opening a foreign currency account abroad with a bank. Prior to 2004, you were not allowed, you, me, as an Indian resident, not allowed to invest abroad or not open a foreign currency bank account. So all what we see, this HSBC accounts which are opened abroad, they're all illegal, because it was opened prior to 2004 without the permission, or the money which came into those accounts were not the legitimate, or it had a tainted transaction. So once LRS money which is going into the foreign currency bank account is permissible, money which has gone from India for the purpose of LRS can be retained in those respective bank account, and from there the investment can take place. But let me tell you, friend, LRS bank account is separate, which is an outflow account. So any money which you, me receive as a professional fees cannot get credit to the respective LRS account which is created abroad. Let's say an ICICI bank in London, you open a bank account abroad and you are allowed to send from here. So 2,50,000, 2,50,000, you have accumulated $1,000,000. And then you got some professional fees of £50,000 from abroad in London. You decided to deposit that into the same bank account and buy a property. Buying a property from that $1,000,000 which is accumulated is allowed. But buying or crediting that revenue which is generated abroad into that account is not allowed. So the various simple funda, what we need to take care is, A, the money which is going from India to abroad for the under the LRS route in a foreign currency account, it is allowed, it can remain there, it can be used. After all the usage, once the investment are liquidated, it can still continue over there. declaring in your FA schedule, offering that income for taxation, we are not touching today. But it is a permissible transaction. But make sure that this money, like a proprietor, you have a business, let's say, and you have opened an LRS account. Some of your client who are abroad, they say, okay, we will deposit that money into that account because the amount is $500 and $1,000 and there is a bank charges of 75 when it comes to India. So I will allow it to retain it only abroad. No, friend, it is not permissible. Under the automatic route, we have two cases where we went to Reserve Bank of India. We said, okay, sir, my client is an exporter. The amount what they are exporting is $100, $200 and all. It becomes very difficult for me to keep a track of it because there is a bank charges involved. Sometimes $75 out of the $100 gets deducted as a bank charges, which you must have also experienced. So how do I protect my business where my business is of $100, $200 and all? So Reserve Bank of India granted him a permission to the Indian company, Indian proprietary, to open a bank account abroad, let it be accumulating on a monthly basis. And they said, whatever is collected on the monthly basis should come back to India on the 7th of the next month. So these are the genuine reason which Reserve Bank of India felt, you know, it is right. Hence, they allowed this party to accumulate the fund abroad. There are various other opportunities for the foreign currency account, which you will see in part 2, ODI part 2, where the companies who are going on exhibition are allowed to open a bank account. People who are going for the trade fair are allowed to open the bank account and come back after that, which we are not going to discuss it today. Today, our topic is only relating to Indian resident taking up investment abroad and opening the bank account LRS outside. Now, let me take you to the 2-3 LRS cases, which has come very famous and which is forming part of the FAQ. Now, can the money which has gone for the purpose of LRS lying in my bank account abroad be used to purchase shares of an Indian company from the foreign national? I'm repeating, there is a foreign national who has invested into India under the FDI route and is holding the shares of an Indian company. You as an individual have an LRS money abroad and you decide to buy the shares from that gentleman. Reserve Bank of India says, no, not possible. LRS money is allowed only to acquire the foreign security. LRS money is not allowed to use to purchase the Indian security. Same way, a one resident cannot give a gift to another resident. Third thing, Indian individual who has invested under the LRS, and if that foreign company invests into India, or if that foreign company invests anywhere else also outside India, it is not permissible. So these are the three classic cases whereby compounding has been passed. You, all the orders are available on the website, and a care needs to be taken when we are giving advice. Because LRS is always used by the individual. They always say, okay, yes, whether it is allowed, not allowed. So we as a professional has to be very thorough. Okay, what amount is allowed? What transactions are allowed? And what purpose it is allowed? So all these things, nuances needs to be taken care while giving the advice. With this, I will complete my session. Over to the audience, over to the participants and the coordinators for the live Q&A for the time which is available. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Rajesh bhai. I'll just run through some of the questions that have come out. And
then I have a proposal. Ravi bhai, can we do live question answer session? We can allow participants to ask question directly. Can we do that? Please, because sir, we also have a half an hour.
I will be happy to solve all the questions raised relating to today's topic.
Okay, let's take it up directly then.
Okay.
I believe we can scan the question and accordingly we can allow respective participant to raise his question directly with Mr. Shah.
Okay.
I think first of all, we can take up Mr. Abhirup Agarwal. He's participants, I'll request you, please do not raise your hands. Only those who have put their questions on the Google form will be allowed to speak here. I'll first of all request our question champ, Abhirup Agarwal. He has got 4 or 5 questions. I'll request Abhirup to clarify 2 of them only, because there are too many questions and we would like to give opportunity to all the participants.
Yes, Abhirup.
Yeah. Abhirup, you're on air.
Am I audible, sir? Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, yes, yeah. Sir. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. My first question is that suppose there's a non-resident who has earned certain money and kept outside India. Now, when he becomes an Indian resident, can he use that money outside India to invest in securities, or is it necessary for him to bring that money back into India and then again send under the LRS scheme?
Let me tell you, friend, Section 6-4 of the FEMA is very clear, which says any money which you have earned outside India, you are allowed to retain it abroad and utilize the way you want it. No restriction from Reserve Bank of India. So by way of 6-4, you will be allowed to retain all the money which is earned outside India, investment outside India, earn income out of India and keep it abroad. My advice is after that he become an Indian resident, he should keep a separate bank account while he is remitting from India, because now he has become an Indian resident. Correct. Indian rule applies. So if he wants to give any gift to another Indian resident, what he had earned outside India, you can give it to the person in India, no restriction. But if any money has gone from India, that money cannot be utilized for giving a gift to another Indian resident. So I hope I am clarified the difference between the money which is earned outside India and after he becoming a resident, what he is remitted under LRS. Over
understood,
to you.
Sir, understood. So my second question is that what is the difference between RFC account and RFC D account?
So RFC account is a resident foreign currency account and RFC D is the domestic account. Technically, both are the same account, but some banks give differentiation.
Okay, so the Indian citizen can also open an RFC account, or he has to open an EFC account compulsory?
No. RFC account is available to only non-resident who has now become resident and want to retain that money in foreign currency account.
Understood, sir.
Whereas EFC account is available only to Indian resident who is earning income from abroad. These are two different things.
Yes, sir, it is clear. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Next, please.
Neeraj ji, whom should I unmute?
Yeah, Ravi, we can start with Sarang Shah.
Mr. Sarang, you may speak now.
Hello. I wanted to know, there's some issue in my mind. It says that I can invest in a share in any company outside of India if I am a resident in India, but I cannot trade in shares in a recognized foreign exchange of another country. Is this okay?
Yes. Now, let me tell you, what is prohibited is a trading. What is allowed is the investment. When you talk about trading, there are chances that you buy and sell on the same day without taking the delivery, which is not allowed. Derivatives transaction where you pay the margin money, it is not allowed. But let's say a trade has to be seen from the regulator point of view. Today you buy the Google share, after 10 days you want to sell and buy the Apple share, you are allowed.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay.
There is one question from Mr. Lakshmi Narayana, but that is from that is more relevant for the topic tomorrow, so we are not raising that question today. There is another question from one of the coordinator, Ravi. Ravi, you can go ahead and speak.
Rajeshji, you said that if a person buys a lottery ticket outside India, that would be considered as an unauthorized transaction out of his travel quota money if he has bought that. So similarly, if a person has gone out on a vacation with some travel quota money and he uses that money to win some huge amount in casino, would that also be considered as unauthorized?
Of course, it will be considered as an unauthorized.
Okay. So it will again lead to compounding and everything.
See, compounding, the person who is going to take compounding will tell you, compounding is allowed of the offenses which are contravention in the form of regulations or certain thing, which is you have not completed filling the form, you have not completed the timing, you have converted but you are not supposed to convert, all those things. The transaction which is void ab initio will not be able to compound, it has to be unwind.
What would be the consequence in such a case?
Sir, I am on the public forum, so I cannot discuss it. What people do on the practical part is a different thing.
I understand.
The session,
sir,
is getting recorded.
Okay, I understand.
Okay. There's another question from Mr. Nagaraju. Can you unmute Mr. Nagaraju, PS Ravi?
Yes, just a second.
I'm not sure whether there's a connect in this question, but in case he has not been able to ask the question properly on the Google form,
Hello.
Mr. Nagaraju, we can hear you.
Yeah. Banning of Unregulated Deposit Act has given a lot of insight into restrictions on the CUPS or transaction between two persons. We see in FEMA many side the CUPS and loaning between residents and non-resident, non-resident to resident. So what is the impact of the banning of Unregulated Deposit Act on FEMA guidelines? Is it overrides or is it subset of this, or how to read both?
Let me tell you, friend, unregulated deposit is a separate BP altogether. FEMA is a separate BP altogether. Okay?
Yes.
When Reserve Bank of India will give you the permission, he will give you under the FEMA Act only. If there is a violation or a contravention relating to another act, they will say, my permission is restricted to this act. Now, if that permission cannot supersede if there is a prohibition under the other act.
Okay.
So both exist mutually, both are parallel, and both has to be taken care of. So classic case is certain investment which comes to India, it meets with the FEMA guideline, but it doesn't meet with the 56 to 10 valuation. Under Reserve Bank of India, any money coming more than what is the valuation is allowed, but then it gets hit by 56 to 10. So whenever a transaction is structured, it should comply with all the laws of the governing land. Right?
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
So there's another question by Aditya S.
Yeah, Mr. Aditya Surana.
Aditya, you can speak now. Aditya, are you there?
You can take another participant.
Yeah.
So there was one more question while Aditya is figuring out his unmute. There was another question by CA Abhirup Agarwal. The limit of $2,000 applies per person, or if a company sends, say, two people abroad, it applies for the company at 2,000.
So when that $2,000 what you are referring is to an individual or a company separately. Now, when an individual has gone on behalf of the company, it is the duty of the individual to receive, when it comes back, surrender the currency back to the company. Only when the individual has taken under the BTQ of his own, that is the time when he can keep and retain $2,000.
Right. So if there were two employees, I'm just reading this question a little more. If I have sent out two employees with $5,000 each, and they came back and gave back to the company $1,500 each. Now, so the company can retain only $2,000 out of that, and $1,000 will have to be surrendered. Is that correct?
But that is our limit is 180 days. They can continue to retain it for 180 days in foreign currency. After 180 days, if nobody has traveled out, they need to surrender it.
I agree. So in this case, in the hypothetical case that we are talking about, where two employees have gone and the company has given them $5,000 each.
So $2,000 can be retained by the company, rest have to be surrendered.
Right. So it is at a entity level that the limit is applicable, not number of employees who are covered in that.
No. Let's say you cannot say if you have sent 200 employees abroad, you can keep 200 into 2,000 each.
Exactly. Exactly. That was the question, and that we have clarified.
Thank you.
Mr. Aditya, are you ready to ask
your question? Am I audible?
Yeah, you are. Please go ahead.
Thanks for allowing me. So going back to one question number one from Abhidu Pagadwal, where the funds earned outside as a non-resident in the outside bank account is freely investable, say he invests in a US company.
Sir, you will have to repeat again, please.
Sure. See, sir, the funds earned outside in a bank account when an individual was non-resident, and that fund is invested in, say, a US company. And when it is invested in a US company, that person has become a resident in India. And that US company has a downstream investment in India. Would it come under the round-tripping restriction?
Okay. So when you're talking about the fund, the role of a person, first we go to 6.4. 6.4 says whatever you have done when you were abroad has no problem. Okay?
Yes.
Yeah. To all the participants who is on the group, please read 6.4 and 6.5. These are the two most fundamental of my whole FEMA. 6.4 says whatever you have done abroad when you were a non-resident, Reserve Bank of India do not touch those things. You can continue in the same form. You can convert the form. You can retain it abroad. No need to bring it back to India. So when this money was invested when the person was a non-resident, and if that fund has invested into India, no problem, no round tripping, even though after he becoming a resident. But if a person is a resident like we all, invest into an US fund, which in future, when I say investment means my total control in that fund may not be 1%, 0.1% or anything. And where we are having no control, then that company investing into India is no problem. But if we are a director of that company, if we are holding more than 10% of that company, we have a say in that company, and if that invests into India, then it's...
Okay.
Next.
Hello. Yes, sir. Another question I had. Can I ask?
Yeah, please go ahead.
So the question where the Indian consultant is given stock options, the first question, stock options in the US holding company of the Indian subsidiary, he is getting that stock options against the services that he provided to Indian company. So would it still be considered as a gift because there is a consideration? No.
That question was little different. Here, it is specifically covered. If a person is a employee, the ESOPs are available only to the employee. If you go to the ESOP regulation, there has to be an employer-employee relationship. Right?
Yeah, sir, he is not an employee, he's a consultant actually. So my question was, he's not an employee, he's a consultant. And he is getting a stock options of the parent company of the Indian company who he served. Instead of getting a cash.
I think what he wants to say, that in lieu of cash, he is getting his consideration in the form of shares.
Yes, and those shares are of US company. And those are free of cost.
Yes, it is not a free of cost. It is in lieu of your services.
Yes, cashless.
So what Reserve Bank of India says is to an individual, the limit is $250,000. So if you are getting the shares of a foreign company and if the limit is within $250,000, it is permissible. There is a specific regulation allowing the same.
Okay.
Thank you. I went to the extent one step further. Even if there is no service and if I'm receiving the shares from the foreign company, it can be treated as a gift and it can be allowed. No restriction.
Okay. So I have one question from a gentleman who seems to have left. That's by Harbir Singh. But because it could be interesting, I'm raising it on his behalf. Can a resident send money under LRS to acquire property jointly with a non-resident or a foreigner?
There is no restriction. So far as whatever money he has remitted outside India and is getting captured in the property as a ownership, no problem.
Right. So participants, if there are any further questions, this is the time to ask because we have completed all the questions that were posted.
I think we can, in that case, allow participants who have raised their hand if there are no more questions available in Google form.
Yeah.
Now, let me tell you, since we are on the property, there is a specific liberalization whereby any Indian resident who is holding the property jointly with a foreign relative where no money is going outside India, it is a permissible transaction.
Right.
So I think Sangeeta ji has raised her hand. So Sangeeta ji, I have allowed you to speak your question and ask your question with Mr. Shah. Sangeeta ji,
yeah.
Over to you.
Yeah, thank you. Sir, I have a question that the employees, those are on merchant navy. What is the treatment for them? Which accounts they can keep? Because they are... they are not resident of any other country and they are always on the ship when they leave and they are less than 182 days in India. We consider them, what status we give them and what accounts they can hold to get their salaries and they get salary paid in USDs.
Sangeeta, good question. I will restrict my answer to the under FEMA, not under the Income Tax Act. Under FEMA, a person who is employed by a merchant navy, because the ship, the commercial ship, what we call, they will be treated as a non-resident and they will be allowed to open the NRE account where the salary can be credited. However, if the ship is owned by the Indian company, then they will not be treated as a non-resident because they are employed by the Indian company.
Okay. And out of that NRE account, can they invest in Indian mutual funds?
Yes. Allowed.
And that will be repatriable?
That will be repatriable. That can go back to the NRE account.
And in that case, is there any requirement of filing anything with the you know, RBI or FEMA, any forms which were told in, when we...
RBI is coming out with the form. Till now, there is no such form. Only when you are investing under that LRS ODI route, you need to report about the investment in shares. Other than that route, no other investment which you buy today abroad or mutual fund or anything is getting captured. But Reserve Bank Governor, Chief General Manager has told us that they are formulating a new FA type of schedule under the FEMA also, where every Indian resident who is holding any securities, any asset abroad, needs to fill in and submit to Reserve Bank of India on a yearly basis. They're coming out with those things.
Here my question is,
that if I am a non-resident, right, I am investing out of my NRE account into Indian mutual funds or, you know, jo bhi hote hain, Kotak Mahindra and all. So, uske liye, do I need to do any filing? That for that...
Filing under FEMA, no. See, FEMA doesn't apply to a non-resident.
Okay. Okay.
The first fundamental, any FEMA rules regulation doesn't apply to a non-resident. So nothing applies, no reporting, nothing. Only if there is a profit gain under Income Tax Act, you file return is a separate issue. No reporting under FEMA.
Okay, okay. Thank you. I have one more question.
Follow-up question. Sangeeta ji, please go ahead.
Okay, the another question is for a student who is studying in US, right? She is having a bank account in, say, HDFC, Indian bank account. I put the money in the bank account and she gets it converted and pay her fee in the school in US. So she is treated as resident, I understand, under FEMA, and she is allowed to do all this?
There is a FEMA circular by Reserve Bank of India specifically for the students abroad. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, when the students goes abroad, I'm talking this, they have to open a bank account. They do some job work, they do some part-time and they earn income abroad. And they deposit that into those accounts.
Okay.
So there is a circular which says you may be treated as a non-resident.
Mm-hmm.
The said student may be treated as a non-resident, and that non-resident person, once he may be treated as a non-resident under FEMA, he can have a bank account abroad, he can earn income abroad and retain it over there. And whatever money you are giving into that local account over here, first of all, it needs to be converted into NRO account if you want to treat it as a non-resident.
No, we don't want to convert it into NRO account because she is a student, right?
So, there is a circular number 45 of 8 December 2003.
Okay.
So this is circular prior to LRS of 4th February 2004. So students who are going abroad, they may take up some just small time employment, or they may receive the money, they may have to open a bank account abroad. So by this circular, they have stated that they may be treated as a non-resident. Not necessarily they have to be.
Okay.
Reason being, if they are not treated as a non-resident, then any income which is generated under surrender of foreign exchange, they have to bring money back to India, then that will be a violation. Hence, you may be treated and you may be treating her as an resident under the Income Tax Act. But under FEMA, if she is not generating any income abroad, fine. Today under LRS, you can send the money to her account there. You can give the money to her account over here. She can convert it and pay the education fees, absolutely fine.
Okay. Thank you so much.
So, I just have a follow-up on Sangeeta ji's question about the ship, the Merchant Navy employee. So,
yes.
If we put it in a different context, if you are on an Indian flagship, okay, that means you are resident in India. If you are not on an Indian flagship, you are considered to be outside India. So until you are on a ship which is flying an, I mean, which is sailing under an Indian flag, therefore you are considered to be in India on that ship. Is that
sir? 1 minute. You are talking under FEMA or under Income Tax Act?
No, I'm talking under FEMA.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. So I was just talking. See, you mentioned that if a Merchant Navy employee is working on a ship which belongs to an Indian company, okay, that person is considered resident. And if the person is working on a ship belonging to another company outside India, then he is considered to be a non-resident. So I'm saying if the ship is flying under an Indian flag. Okay, that means you are considered to be in India even though you are on that ship, which may be on high seas. Is that interpretation correct from a FEMA perspective?
Okay, let me go to the definition of FEMA, under FEMA of a resident. Okay, If you go to 2 Roman V, what does it say? If a person who is going abroad for the purpose of employment, okay, for the purpose of employment, here is a case, if he's on an Indian ship, he is not going abroad for the purpose of employment. Correct. He is not starting a business or a vocation. He is not going for a period, for an indefinite period, which is the intention of staying abroad.
Right.
So he doesn't become a non-resident under FEMA. That 182 days clause which has come for the previous year are for different ramification. If he goes employ for the purpose of employment for a foreign ship, then he is treated as a non-resident.
Agreed.
So that is the reason I asked you whether you're talking under income tax, because under income tax, only the travel outside India is there. For the purpose of employment is not there under income tax act.
Understood. There's one question which has come from Mr. J. Purnachandar.
Yes.
Ravi, can you unmute him?
Doing it right away.
Yeah, Mr. Ravi, any other left? Any questions?
Just a second. Mr. Purnachandar, you may speak now. Mr. Purnachandar, please unmute yourself and speak.
Hello.
Yeah, we can hear you. Please be a little louder.
Thank you.
We can't hear you, Purnachandra ji.
Okay, I'll ask his question. It's a fairly straightforward question. Can a person who became resident and ordinary resident hold maintain NRE account?
Answer is no. First of all, there is no concept of ordinary resident. That is an income tax nomenclature. Under FEMA, either you are a resident or a non-resident. So if you have become a resident, then all your NRE account, NRO account has to be converted into the local account.
Ravi, we have a couple of hand raises. One is Mr. Lakshmi Narayana. So shall I allow him to talk or are you doing it?
Ask the question also.
I think we should wrap up question answer session in next 3 or 4 minutes because we also have a lot of thanks and we have to conclude the session by 7 also.
Yes. We will take one last question from Mr. Lakshmi Narayana. Mr. Lakshmi Narayana, you may speak, please.
Yeah, thank you for considering. See, this is a follow-through question of Ajay. Okay, so Ajay was saying a consultant rendered service to an Indian company. However, the Indian company has not paid the consultant individual. He is getting the employee stock option from a overseas company in terms of a consideration. Okay, so how this will be permitted under normal scenario, sir?
So Lakshmi Narayan, as I said, first of all, I had the same question. A consultant is not eligible for the ESOPs. First, let me put it the ESOP definition. ESOP is always available only to the employees of the company or group companies. Still, I went further and said, if I am rendering services for which I am being remunerated by a foreign company by way of shares, there is a specific regulation which permits me, provided the total value of the shares is less than $250,000. And third, even if I go to the extent of saying, what I am getting is a gift, that is also permissible under the ODA regulation part 3.
Correct. But ESOP is not permitted. That's what I wanted to get confirmation.
No, it can't be called an ESOP. The whole question is, you can't call something an ESOP if it is given to a person who is not an employee.
Perfect. See, we had a similar requirement from, I am from bank. So we had a similar requirement from one of the customer where he had rendered services to Indian company. However, the payment they wanted to make in the form of a foreign company's ESOP to a consultant. So which we said it cannot be done because the minimum requirement for allotting a ESOP should be the person should be an employee to the company. So that's where we have declined the transaction. So that's
Mr. Lakshmi Narayan, what I said or what your bank has done are the same thing.
Okay.
And what I mean, just taking it a bit further on what Rajesh is saying, if you should not be calling it ESOP, but if it is allotment of shares in lieu of services provided, up to $250,000, that can be done is what Rajesh is saying.
Yes. But in that case also, you don't have to remit money from India because you are getting in lieu of your professional services.
Correct. So, Mr. Bholusaria, you had one follow-up question on Sangeetaji, so we can take that last one and then...
You have already asked that question. You took words from my mouth.
So, telepathy works on Zoom also. Anyway, so thank you so much, Rajeshji, and I would suggest that we propose a vote of thanks to all the participants for the nice questions and Rajeshji and all the other organizers here.
Vikram, I would request, Vikram will be taking the vote of thanks.
Yeah, Vikram, are you there? Vikram Parwani?
No worries, sir. We as a speaker also have enjoyed a lot to all the questions.
Hello.
Yeah, Vikram is there.
Yeah, Vikram, bhai, please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, everybody. I deem it a great honor and privilege to proffer the vote of thanks. In opening session today, Dinesh Bhai appreciated Rajesh Ji as Chota Packet. And I found really as Chota Packet a bada dhamaka. I, on behalf of FTAP and CTC Hyderabad, with the entire team, and on my behalf, I thank CA Rajesh Shah, who despite his busy schedule has found time for this platform. I want to thanks for his wonderful presentation and his valuable contribution, especially the way he dealt with the QA session. It impressed me a lot. On the other side, I would also like to thanks to this virtual technology who made us unite at this platform in this COVID period. Now, I would thanks to all distinguished invitees and participants today. Now, I think we should wrap up this session as my seniors convey. We thank you for being with us.
Rajeshji, we have a certificate of appreciation for you. We will be sending it to you through email, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you, the organizers. Thank you, participants. Connect. See you soon. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much. Ravi, is there any administrative announcement for the next session or something? Or do we have tomorrow's session on schedule? Yeah. Okay. Thank you.